Before we get started, bear with me for a second. Let me address the white elephant in the room.
We need to acknowledge the elephant in the room.
This year, we probably won't get a traditional college football season, and honestly, we'll be fortunate if we even get an abbreviated version of what we're used to. So unfortunately for a lot of the players that will be eligible for the 2021 NFL Draft, they likely won't be able to add as much to their NFL resume as they're likely hoping for. The good news is that you can already start scouting guys for the 2020 NFL Draft, but the bad news is that a lot of this is projecting typical improvements from players in their junior or senior seasons. I'm going to go through this as if we're going to get some kind of college football season, and these guys will get a chance to show their development as if it's business as usual, because you don't need to be reminded of the current state of the world in every single pick. With that said, I hope everyone is doing well throughout all of this, and I would love to recommend that you start your own online hobby during all of this so that you can focus more time alone and indoors. If you have any questions on how to get started or what you need to develop some kind of online hobby, my Twitter DMs are always open, and I'm always trying to help potential creators. If you guys can help me and hit the like button on that video, I would greatly appreciate it. The goal is 1,000 likes for this 2020 NFL mock draft. The order is going to be based on the Vegas odds. I'm so glad this has become a trend, because I remember back in the day making these and people would always complain about the order. So don't blame me, blame Vegas. But honestly, last year's preseason odds were pretty good, with the Dolphins, Cardinals, Redskins, Raiders, and Giants making up the top five. I think the Raiders ended up doing the best of all of those teams, but we're still only the 12th pick. But yeah, without further ado, the Jacksonville Jaguars have been granted the number one pick by the odds makers in Vegas. It almost doesn't matter which team ends up with the first overall pick, they're going to be taking Trevor Lawrence. That's how good this dude is. He's the best college quarterback prospect since Andrew Luck, but hopefully his career has more injury success than the former Colts quarterback. You thought I was going to make a Luck pun, didn't you? With a need and the ammunition to potentially trade up if necessary, the Jaguars are the clear favorites for Trevor Lawrence in 2021. They have a chance to rebuild similarly to the way that the Dolphins have done it, but it may also require a front office talent dump this year. They were even rumored to be called the Trevor Lawrence team during the 2020 NFL draft among NFL GMs, because they were asking for 2021 picks in many of the pre-draft trade discussions. It is, after all, a copycat league. At number two overall, I've got the Redskins selecting Oregon offensive tackle Penei Sewell. The Redskins waited too long in trading Trent Williams, and the compensation dropped significantly. The Redskins also failed to get a worthy replacement for Trent Williams. Sewell is the Andrew Thomas in this draft class. Not that they're the same player, but they were both the number one offensive lineman going into their final season, and it'll be interesting to see if we're overanalyzing Sewell next April in the NFL draft, or if people act like he's this new player because of the East Coast bias. If the Redskins are picking this high, either Dwayne Haskins got hurt, or he was absolutely terrible, and he could get the bust label after two seasons. If it is the latter, then Haskins could be supplanted by the same guy that replaced him at Ohio State in Justin Fields here. At number three, we've got the Bengals. They got their franchise quarterback in Joe Burrow in the 2020 draft, a new go-to wide receiver, and the offensive line should have a lot more depth this year, but the defense didn't get the upgrade it needed during the 2020 offseason, and they're going to need to get the best defensive player available in the 2021 NFL draft. The Miami Hurricanes haven't had a first-round pick since tight end David Njoku in 2017, and so much can change between now and next April, but Miami has a couple players that seem worthy of a high draft pick. The guy with the best odds is edge rusher Gregory Rousseau. He is a freak athlete, an elite pass rusher that is barely scratching the surface. 15 is not only his jersey number, but is also the number of sacks that he should be shooting for every season. Barring some kind of meltdown, Rousseau is going to be an early pick in the 2021 NFL draft. And I know it's hard to believe, but the best pass rusher in the draft won't be coming out of Ohio State for a change. But just wait for Tyreek Smith in 2022 though. At number four, we've got the Carolina Panthers, and I know that optimism is high in the Carolinas for these Panthers, and I'm not trying to reduce that feeling, because every team should be looking for a Matt Rhule to build a healthy and successful football program. And Joe Brady could be the next young offensive mind that everybody wants to get their hands on. I don't want to call him the next McVay, because that became kind of its own meme, but the Panthers feel like they are in rebuild mode based on the move that they made. It actually looks like a smart and well thought out strategy to get a full squad in place before injecting a dynamic rookie quarterback. Nothing against Cam Newton, but he is a polarizing personality that would make it difficult for a new head coach to come in and install his own culture. So now the Panthers are in a great situation to let Teddy Bridgewater and Phil Walker come in and essentially fight for the future backup quarterback situation. Poor Teddy has been getting the Josh Rosen treatment since Josh Rosen was setting up an inflatable hot tub in his freshman dorm room. But I'm sure the Panthers are hoping to flip Phil Walker for some draft capital if he gets a chance to shine at some point. And Teddy's contract is set up for them to get out of after two seasons, So unless he comes in and produces like a college Joe Burrow, I expect the Panthers to be front runners for one of the top quarterbacks in the 2021 NFL draft, and then moving on from Teddy Bridgewater after a couple seasons. Trevor Lawrence would be a natural fit as the first Clemson player ever drafted by the local Panthers, but I don't think the Panthers will be bad enough to get into the first overall pick. However, Justin Fields is such an interesting NFL prospect, and the Panthers would be more likely to get themselves in position for him. And if the Panthers do end up tanking this season, don't feel bad for them, because the Panthers fans would be spoiled to have only a year and a half or two, whatever you want to call it, between two dynamic franchise quarterbacks like this. At number five, we've got the Jets, and they got a steal last year in cornerback Bryce Hall. You know, I love my UVA guys, but their secondary still needs some upgrades, and we've got the son of a former AFC East All-Pro in this draft. I could be jaded by the family genes, but I'm really excited by the potential of his son, Patrick Surtain II. He's bigger than his dad, but has all the same ball skills and athleticism. I think every boy remembers the day that they realized that they had physically surpassed their dad, and for Surtain II, that was probably his freshman year of high school, if not sooner. He was probably the best cornerback on the Crimson Tide defense as a sophomore. Now he's really got a chance to shine on his own. I think he's going to end up being a very high pick in April. Before we move on, I want to take a minute to thank my mock draft sponsor, Manscaped. For those that don't know, Manscaped is the only men's brand that is dedicated to below-the-waist grooming and hygiene. And if you haven't noticed, the world is starting to open up again, and like many of us, you've probably ignored some personal hygiene to a dangerously hairy level. Now is the time to get things back in order with the new 3.0 waterproof body trimmer from Manscaped. I'm a huge fan of Manscaped and their Perfect Package Essentials Kit, which is the world's first all-in-one manscaping kit that makes manscaping safe and easy. And with their newly released Lawnmower 3.0 waterproof body trimmer, they have taken this grooming thing to the next level. They've added a no-slip grip so you don't drop it in the shower or worse, an LED light that illuminates areas for closer grooming, and a rapid charge dock for those times when you find a dead battery and you just can't wait for things to charge. And all of these are to complement the trademark skin-safe technology. You can probably tell from my videos that I am definitely a quality over quantity kind of guy, and Manscaped products are top-notch. As a subscriber, you can get 20% off and two free gifts added on if you use my promo code NFL20, that's NFL20. Thanks again to Manscaped for sponsoring this video. Now let's get back to the 2021 NFL mock draft. At number six, we've got the Giants, and they continue to neglect the linebacker position in the draft. They also signed free agent Blake Martinez from the Packers, but when a linebacker needy team lets one of their best linebackers go, you need to have realistic expectations of how high the ceiling is for that player. The Giants might not have wanted to use a top five pick on a futuristic linebacker in Isaiah Simmons, but Micah Parsons is a throwback linebacker from Penn State, the school that has produced a ton of throwback linebackers over the year. Legend has it that once upon a time, they were actually called Linebacker U. At number seven, we've got the Lions, and the Lions have used and abused some of the top defensive tackle prospects over the last decade and pretty much have nothing to show for it. Marvin Wilson is the Derrick Brown of this draft. He could have been a top defensive tackle taken in 2020, but he went back to school and will be a top pick next year. And you know that this dude is just a different breed when he is a big, sloppy defensive tackle rocking the number 21. At number eight, we've got the Dolphins on the clock, and I think they're going to be able to improve their wide receiving core with one of these first round picks that they have next year. And the draft class looks to be just as, if not more loaded than the 2020 class. LSU's Ja'Marr Chase is going to be the number one wide receiver on a lot of people's boards, but I'm all in on Justin Ross and have been for a long time. In my opinion, he's just as good as Chase, but in a 6'4 frame. Ja'Marr Chase doesn't have Joe Burrow this year, so his production could take a big hit, while Trevor Lawrence could be primed to put together the best full season we've seen from him, and Justin Ross is his number one wide receiver now that T. Higgins is gone. But the Dolphins could try to do Tua Tagovailoa a solid and get him one of the two draft eligible wide receivers he played with at Alabama. Those guys are really tough to project though, because I do think that Ja'Marr Chase is slightly better NFL prospect than Devontae Smith, but Jalen Waddle has that speed that teams reach on, so it's really hard to figure out where you think he's going to go. All four guys could be in play for the Dolphins next year, and adding speed could be the preferred choice opposite of Devontae Parker. At number nine, the Dolphins are back on the clock, but this time with the Texans pick, and they've done a really good job of filling their holes, and these two first rounders are going to be the cherries on top of a rebuild that provides a ton of optimism and potential for the Dolphins' future. The only position I see a glaring hole going into 2020 is at the free safety position, and Javon Holland from Oregon looks like a really promising prospect going into the season. He is super athletic and has rangy ball skills, but he's not being overhyped going into the season like Grant Delpit was, so he won't be under a microscope and inevitably disappoint us. The Oregon safety has 9 interceptions in his first 2 seasons and would be the center fielder that the Dolphins defense needs. At number 10, we've got the Broncos, and they declined the fifth-year option on left tackle Garrett Bowles, which is usually the earliest moment that a team will basically declare a first-rounder a bust. Unless he gets it together this year, the Broncos will likely need a new left tackle in 2021. After going all in to provide his young quarterback with all the toys a kid could ask for, John Elway could go back to his Stanford roots and select Walker Little to be the blindside blocker for Drew Lock. He's actually a better run blocker than a pass protector, though, and is coming off an injury, but was a good enough athlete at the position and just looks like an ideal traditional offensive tackle, which I think is going to really hit home for John Elway. At number 11, we've got the Falcons, and if the Falcons are picking in the top 15, something went really wrong again. It might be time just to blow the whole thing up and start over with a new coaching staff, and a new coaching staff usually equates to starting over at the quarterback position too. And the Falcons might need to grab a guy for the future here and look to send Matt Ryan elsewhere. I don't think there's anything wrong with Matt Ryan as a quarterback, but when you are underachieving on a yearly basis, you gotta look at the leaders on the team and reevaluate. Jamie Newman was one of the best quarterbacks the Wake Forest has ever had and elevated the entire team. Now he's a graduate transfer at Georgia and is surrounded by top recruited talent from across the country and will get a chance to shine in more of a national spotlight. Georgia fans got robbed of the Justin Fields experience, but don't feel bad for them because the Jamie Newman Bulldogs might be just as good. At number 12, we've got the Cardinals, and they didn't do too much to improve the pass rush in 2020 and will continue to lean heavily on Chandler Jones, so it's going to continue to be a big need for them going into 2021. And speaking of Wake Forest, they do have a quality edge rusher in Carlos Basham Jr. He might be a little bigger than your typical 3-4 outside linebacker, but he's good enough of an athlete and could shed some weight if necessary. There's some other pass rushers available that might be better scheme fits, but Basham is definitely higher on the NFL radar right now. At number 13, we've got the Bears, and the Bears are going to find themselves at a crossroads after this 2020 NFL season. The biggest question will be, who are they rolling with at quarterback moving forward? Does Trubisky take a step forward and convince Ryan Pace to sign up for a few more years, or does Nick Foles offer them some stability that they're not used to? To me, both options sound terrible, but I think the latter is the easiest to swallow moving forward. This could be a team targeting a quarterback in the NFL draft, but I expect that they'll try and roll with the veteran retread first. I've mentioned in my multi-round mock drafts when I had the Bears taking a wide receiver, and Bears fans were kind of annoyed by it, but Allen Robinson is a free agent in 2021, and I don't know if he's going to re-sign with Chicago. Back in 2018, he thought he was signing with an up-and-coming head coach quarterback duo in Mitch Trubisky and Matt Nagy. I think it's safe to say that Allen Robinson got sold a lemon, and I could be completely wrong. He could love the city of Chicago so much that he gives them a hometown discount and re-ups with the Bears, but my feeling would be that he is set up to get one more big-time contract, and hopefully he won't be coming off of a torn ACL this time around, so he finds the best quarterback and cap space situation. It offers him a big payday and a Super Bowl run. This wide receiving class is going to be too good to pass up on, and Ja'Marr Chase would be a better option for the Bears than investing in an older wide receiver with their cap situation. But if Ryan Pace is still the GM, then throw out all kinds of logic. At number 14, we've got the Raiders, and they are another team that could be interested in the quarterback position in 2021, but much like the Bears, I think they prefer to jumpstart the career of a veteran, and they happen to have a guy already under contract in Marcus Mariota. The Raiders have been using veteran band-aids at defensive tackle alongside Mo Hurst, and assuming that Malik Collins and John Hankins don't earn a big payday from them, this is likely one of the bigger needs for the Raiders going into the 2021 NFL draft. Mike Mayock is clearly watching film from the Alabama-Clemson championship games, so why not grab the next Alabama defensive lineman in Christian Barmore. Barmore didn't actually play in those games, but you know, I just couldn't help myself. At number 15, we've got the Cleveland Browns, and they did a really good job of shoring up the offensive line on paper, but in a year where continuity is going to be key, the Browns could still be looking for an upgrade. However, the Odell Beckham Jr. trade rumors won't go away, and it feels like a ticking time bomb. If the Browns aren't a high-flying offense in 2020, OBJ will be asking every team on the second half of the Browns' schedule to come and get him. Kevin Stefanski didn't do a great job keeping Stephon Diggs' emotions in check, so it'll be interesting to see how this relationship pans out. With or without OBJ, this offense could use more of a speed threat, which is what I think they were hoping they would get out of Antonio Callaway. Rondale Moore is a really fun player and a sleeper to be the first wide receiver taken in this draft class based on performances at the NFL Combine. He's small, but he's well built, and he's got the game-breaking speed that teams will reach on. At number 16, we've got the Titans. And they have quietly built a pretty stacked roster and reinforced some of their holes for the future in the 2020 NFL Draft. Derrick Henry is going to be playing on the franchise tag this year, and it will be interesting to see how the Titans handle this contract moving forward, but I don't see Travis Etienne being the preferred choice for the Titans, and you guys know how I feel about running backs in the first round. However, Travis Etienne may be a different dude. He just doesn't seem to fit the offensive personality that they're looking for here in Tennessee. If wide receiver Corey Davis's contract expires after the season, and he'll probably be looking for a fresh start elsewhere if he doesn't have a breakout season. Edge rush could still be a need heading into 2021, but assuming Harold Landry takes another step in his development and Vic Beasley doesn't have another double-digit season and sign elsewhere, I think he might be a solid option for a re-sign next year, grab some depth in the later round of the draft, and for some reason, Jadeveon Clowney is still an option too. So as of this way too early mock draft and the question marks on offense at running back and wide receiver, I'm going to splurge here and have the Titans grab another offensive weapon for the passing game, but this time it is the top tight end available. Florida's tight end, Kyle Pitts, is better than any of the tight ends from the 2020 NFL draft. His status as tight end one in this draft will hinge on the progression of Florida's quarterback, Kyle Trask. Kyle Pitts is listed at 6'5", 235, but he doesn't look that big on the field. Maybe it's the 84, but he actually looks and moves a bit like Corey Davis, which at tight end is a complete mismatch. Penn State's tight end, Pat Freiermuth, is more of a traditionally built tight end, so he might be more of a fit for the Titans' current ground and pound style, but these way too early mock drafts are almost a big board slash season preview of teams, so the team with the highest need of tight end and the top tight end moving forward line up together, even if they might not actually be the best scheme fit overall. At number 17, we've got the Jaguars back on the clock, and this pick might end up being sacrificed if they mess around and win too many games and then need to trade up to get Trevor Lawrence or Justin Fields. But here, I'm giving them a player that I'm in love with on the defensive side of the ball. He is the Derwin James, Isaiah Simmons of this class for me. Hamsa Nasruldeen is a 6'4 star from Florida State that can do it all. That's not me calling him a star. That's literally what they call the hybrid safety linebacker position of the Seminoles defense, the star position. He's only 215 pounds, so he's not quite in the weight class of Derwin James, or definitely not Isaiah Simmons, and will likely stay at safety in the NFL until he puts on some good weight, and his frame would certainly allow it. In the meantime, he could play as a nickel linebacker. He's got a nose for forcing fumbles, a high motor that any defense coordinator would love to get their hands on, but who knows what kind of defense the Jaguars will be running in the future. At number 18, we've got the Vikings, and after solidifying the cornerback group in the 2020 NFL draft, the Vikings have some long-term decisions to be made at the safety position next year. I'm not kicking Harrison Smith out the door, but at 31, he's getting up there and only has 1 year left on his deal after the 2020 NFL season, and Anthony Harris is playing on the franchise tag. The Vikings like to address their needs a year early, and with the quality safeties in the upcoming draft, it'd be a good time to return to that proactive philosophy. Syracuse actually has an NFL prospect, and it's safety Andre Sisco, number 19 for the Orangemen. He'd be an ideal addition to add to whomever the Vikings decide to keep long term, because both Harrison and Harris are best suited as strong safeties, but Sisco is a center field ball hawk free safety. At number 19, we've got the Chargers, and they didn't get the upgraded offensive line other than the Trey Turner addition, but they had to borrow from the offensive tackle depth to improve at guard. Brian Bulaga is not your franchise left tackle for Justin Herbert, so this is where the Chargers need to start in the 2021 NFL draft. Alex Leatherwood could have been a high draft pick in the 2020 draft. He went back to school and kind of wonder if he's regretting that choice now. He's already got one of the best names in the upcoming draft and is going to be one of the most athletic offensive linemen in the upcoming draft. At number 20, we've got the Steelers, and they should probably let Bud Dupree walk in free agency next year to save money for TJ Watt's upcoming contract. They also didn't add another pass rusher to groom for that upcoming need, so that means that it will be likely addressed next year with a rookie. Quincy Roche spent the last 3 years at Temple, and now is a graduate transfer that chose Miami to play opposite of Gregory Rousseau, which is a smart move. He's a little undersized, but he would be a really good fit in the Steelers' defense. Roche might end up being a big riser if he and Gregory Rousseau hit their stride together and become a dynamic pass rushing duo. At pick number 21, we've got the Colts, and they are an interesting team to project. If they do this well, then it was most likely a successful year with Phillip Rivers. Is Rivers now going to come back for another shot, or is this a one and done scenario? Either way, the Colts secondary has been an Achilles heel of this defense for a while, and their attempt to revive Xavier Rhodes' career is a prime example of how badly they are grasping at straws to try and patch it up. Ohio State might not have an elite edge rusher coming out this year, but they do have another top-level cornerback in Sean Wade. He's been a slot cornerback with two first-rounders playing outside of him, but he'll get his shot playing boundary corner now that those guys are gone, so we'll see how he projects as a number one cornerback in the NFL. But based on the physical mold, looking like another guy coming off the line at the Ohio State cornerback factory, this guy will probably end up being a much higher draft pick. At number 22, I've got the New England Patriots, and if they are picking in the early 20s, then their play at quarterback probably worked out, whether it's Jared Stidham or another option coming through for them. But I'm still using this pick to highlight another quarterback to keep your eye on for the future, and that's Stanford transfer KJ Costello. Costello was already a classic NFL prototype at the quarterback position, and he played in a pro-style offense at Stanford. Now he's linking up with Mike Leach at Mississippi State to run his air raid offense, so the production should be there against SEC defenses. This guy will be a fast riser if things go well for Mike Leach in his first year. And I know what some of you are thinking right now. How is this guy going to put KJ Costello on here before Trey Lance? First of all, please stop acting like you've known about Trey Lance for more than like a week. I get it. Trey Lance is the flavor of the week, and I'm not sure why there wasn't more hype about this kid during the college season because he had an insane level of production. His decision-making and dominance at North Dakota State are things you hope for from an elite prospect playing against a lower level of competition. The numbers he put up remind me of the days where you would create yourself in NCAA football and, you know, you'd turn all the sliders all the way up. You'd be a 99 overall true freshman with 99 speed, 99 throw power, and then you'd play on freshman difficulty level on your way to three straight Heisman trophies. RIP to the NCAA football video games, by the way. North Dakota State is kind of getting spoiled with these quarterbacks, though. They went from Carson Wentz to Easton Stick, and if you combined both of them and then cranked up the natural athleticism all the way, now you've got Trey Lance. But I think it's the zero interceptions that stand out the most with him. We've seen insane production from guys that flame out in the NFL, but I can't remember someone not having a single lapse in judgment that didn't result in an interception. But Lance has a couple more seasons of eligibility, and NFL scouts are going to want to see the follow-up to this video game season of his. I know I said I wasn't going to bring up the uncertainty of the upcoming football season, but you've got to question if it's even going to be wise for a guy like him from a small school to enter the 2021 NFL draft without a real slate of games to play. I hate to be the Trey Lance party pooper because I'm excited to see this guy enter the NFL also, but he's probably got another 2 years of a wait before we see him. Let's get back on track. At number 23, I've got the Buffalo Bills. They are rolling with Josh Norman as the number two cornerback position opposite of Tre'Davious White. And I think that they are really banking on Norman being back in Sean McDermott's system, being the key to reviving his career. It's a move that could pay off, but I watched Norman closely in Washington, and honestly, he's one of those guys that burns too bright too quickly, and once they're burnt out, it's really hard for them to recapture that. Stanford cornerback Paulson Adebo was another top cornerback that I thought would enter the 2020 NFL draft, but went back to school. We'll see if that pays off, but Adebo projects as a solid outside cornerback with very few weaknesses. At number 24, we've got the Packers, and they were the joke of the 2020 NFL draft after one of the more confusing draft classes we've ever seen. They passed on the stacked wide receiver class for a backup quarterback, a backup running back, and a fullback. So they have to go wide receiver next year, right? I like the fit with Devontae Smith to form the Devontae brothers. The question is whether or not there will be enough touchdowns to go around for these guys. At number 25, we got the Eagles. I felt like the Eagles really needed a cornerback early in the 2020 NFL draft, despite adding Darius Slay. But much like the Packers, they were too busy drafting a backup quarterback with a prime draft pick. So maybe they allow Sidney Jones the chance to redeem himself, or just hope that one of these other cornerbacks with an expiring contract will rise to the top and they re-sign that guy. But as a backup plan, Virginia Tech's Caleb Farley is a guy I could see them liking to play outside corner opposite of Darius Slay, moving Avante Maddox to play inside at the slot. It's been a while since Virginia Tech has produced a defensive back like this after sending a top guy almost every year. Farley is a big, long cornerback with really good ball skills. At pick number 26, we got the Seahawks, and they really just don't care about Russell Wilson's well-being, do they? They literally won a Super Bowl with him on one of the most stacked rosters in the last decade, and then paid him the big contract and basically said, okay, now it's all on you. And you know what? He's put the team on his back. They did make the move to get Dwayne Brown from the Texans, but every other offensive lineman they've had recently has been a low-budget free agent deal or a late-round draft pick. So I'm going to keep giving them an offensive lineman. And Iowa's left tackle, Alaric Jackson, pushed Tristan Wirfs to the right side of the offensive line there in Iowa. And he's built similarly to Wirfs, so he could potentially play left tackle in the NFL, but could move inside if necessary. At number 27, Vegas has the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Now, does anybody think that this Tom Brady thing is going to last more than a year? I don't, and the Buccaneers probably avoided adding a young quarterback in the draft to ensure Brady that they used every resource possible for a Super Bowl run this year. That means they're going to be in the quarterback market next year. And I don't know, this guy Jameis Winston is scheduled to be a free agent, so maybe they could go that route if they wanted. But assuming they don't, the local kid from Florida, Kyle Trask, seems like he'd be a potential fit for the Bucs. He's got the big, strong frame that Bruce Arians likes in his quarterback, and is a decent enough athlete. I'm not sure if the arm strength is quite in the league of Carson Palmer or Big Ben or Andrew Luck, but it's strong enough to get the job done, and he'll be coming off of a year in which he had to accommodate for Brady's 42-year-old noodle arm, so most guys are going to see like they've got more juice. At number 28, they've got the Dallas Cowboys, and I usually like to complain about the Cowboys have avoided drafting a safety, but there's no room for complaining after that 2020 draft class. Haha, Clinton Dix is going to be the starter at safety this year and may re-up next year because he appears to be a decent scheme fit for what the Cowboys want to do. But if they don't want to be mocked to safety every year, then they should just go ahead and address the position for us with more than just a band-aid. There's a much better safety class in 2021, and I love Caden Stearns out of Texas. He's got the size the Cowboys want out of their defensive backs, and showed some ball hawk ability as a freshman. Teams avoided him in his sophomore year, so hopefully he can have a bounce back year in 2020 and show more of those ball hawking skills. At number 28, we've got the New Orleans Saints, and they usually take a unique approach to the NFL draft, but if you do a quick projection of their team, they appear to be set up to be a dynamic offense if Jameis Winston is brought back to be the starter in 2021 while Drew Brees rides off into the sunset to begin his broadcasting career and call Notre Dame games for NBC. The offensive line is set up to be the strength of the team, and Michael Thomas will get as many chances as he wants to torch defenses deep down the field with Winston's cannon compared to the finesse passing from Drew Brees. Emmanuel Sanders, however, is 33 years old and wasn't signed for the long term, so wide receiver will be a need once again, unless Traquan Smith elevates his game drastically. But this offense is still missing a vertical speed threat, and if Jaylen Waddle enters the draft, he could wind up being a fast riser with probably a 4.2 40 time at the combine, but it's hard to see him elevating himself past the top guys in this draft class right now. At number 30, we got the 49ers, and I expected the 49ers to improve their cornerback depth in the draft, but it wasn't addressed, and with another year of miles added on to Richard Sherman's odometer, the 49ers will have to start prepping for the future. At 6'1", Georgia's Eric Stokes has the size that they're looking for down by the bay, and he is a track star that will be able to run with the best of them. Georgia's secondary is actually full of NFL players, and Stokes could be the best of the bunch, but keep an eye on Tyson Campbell as a guy that the NFL could fall in love with too. Now, the order of these last two picks show you why you can't fully trust Vegas to make the order, because we've only got the Ravens and Chiefs left, and at 31 we have got the Ravens, who after solidifying the inside of their defense with two new linebackers, the Ravens will need to turn their attention to the outside and reinforce the pass rush at some point. Matthew Judon might play himself out of Baltimore with another big season, but even if he takes a step back production-wise, they bring him back, I think they still need to add another weapon to get after the quarterback. Big Cat Bryant just feels like he's meant to be playing for a team known for historically playing lights-out defense, and when his actual name is Markavius Bryant, it seems fitting for that team to be the rival of the team that once had Martavis Bryant. Maybe that's just me, but Big Cat is a really good athlete that is just destined for a 3-4 team. He's the man on that Auburn defense now, with the losses of Derrick Brown, Marlon Davidson, and Nick Coe to the NFL in the 2020 draft, but that could lead to Big Cat being an absolute force, racking up the production and sacks. He is a dark horse to give Gregory Rousseau some comp as the top pass rusher in the draft. At number 32, going back-to-back according to Vegas, the Kansas City Chiefs are back on the clock, and they leave no stone unturned when looking for cornerbacks, but that has got to be exhausting for the front office resources, so they could look to add some stability from the draft. Andy Reid was with the Eagles when they gave Asante Samuel Sr. a contract after his time with the Patriots, and Samuel actually had a lot of success with the Eagles, which has not been the typical result for Patriots transplants over the last decade plus, but Asante Samuel had 23 interceptions in 5 seasons with the Eagles after 22 in the previous 5 with the New England Patriots. Asante Samuel Jr. is not the preferred size for the position anymore, but he's an NFL legacy player and possesses a similar nose for getting his hands on the ball like his dad. He had 23 pass breakups in his first 2 years at Florida State, including 14 in 2019. I do apologize for the delay on this mock draft. My birthday was on May 7th, and then we had Mother's Day, and I contemplated doing something about the NFL schedule, but it feels kind of bittersweet to have the NFL schedule released. And I was thinking about going into detail on what we can expect from this upcoming NFL season, or football season in general, but it might be an uncomfortable topic, and I wanted to ask you guys what you wanted from me. Should I acknowledge the potential issues with the upcoming seasons in videos? Should I make a video about it specifically and just put it all out there? Or should I just pretend like everything is going to go as planned and we're gonna get a full NFL season this year? Your opinion not only matters to me on the subject, but it's literally everything. I feel like I could go either way.
That's what she said.
But I can inject a little bit of pessimism or realism and let you guys know that it's not actually looking that good. Or I could just ignore the white elephant all day long until we're faced with a different reality. Please let me know in the comments below what you think. At least hit the like button on another comment that describes a sentiment that you might also be feeling. And then be safe out there. Take this stuff mostly seriously, but still get outside and do things with those closest to you. Get fresh air, exercise, and don't touch your face when you're outside of your house. That way, I will see you all in the next video.